Non si va in cielo,
non si va in cielo,
in pinin farina,
in pinin farina,
perché in cielo,
perché in cielo,
non c'è la benzina,
non c'è la benzina,
non si va in cielo, in pinin farina, perché in cielo non c'è la benzina, aia oh, aia.
Well, I greet everybody, and I thank God, especially in a day like this, where we are celebrating Christ the King. And for all of us that give the Lordship to Jesus, today couldn't be greater, because we really understand what it means, Christ the King. We do know, and therefore we celebrate it, because I guess it's the greatest feast for us to understand that His kingdom is not of this world, and that we are pilgrims traveling to that kingdom. And that is what leads us into this great mystery of purgatory, because it is also part of the climbing up the mountain of Zion to make it to the city of light. So we cannot overlook the reality of purgatory on our way up. So Christ the King represents for us today in this Congress this kingdom that awaits for us, that is in us already, in our hearts, like he was telling Saint Faustina, that his kingdom lives in each one of our hearts. And each one that receives him as the king, that gives him the lordship. And it's so wonderful to understand this, because this is what our faith is all about understanding that we are pilgrims and that we are actually moving on towards that kingdom of God, that promise of Jesus. He was always talking about it. And he was so eager to make sure we get it, you know, we understand. We know what happened during his public life and how people, one of them, Judas Iscariot, were disappointed because they thought he was going to be an earthly king and was going to defeat the Romans and free the people of God. So that's how, as far as they got. And some of the apostles at times were thinking that, but Jesus was elevating them time and time again above that. But it took the Holy Spirit to come upon all of them for them to begin to understand that he was actually really talking about a kingdom that is not of this world. And it's so important to place ourselves there. I am so honored to be in this virtual space of this weekend with Bishop John and all the priests that join us, and John Hesketh from Liverpool, and all the witnesses, because each one gave a vision very clear about purgatory, and also we receive from Bishop John and the priest especially a very structured ecclesiastical presentation of purgatory, and also their personal testimonies that complement their priestly experiences and the studies they had, combined with their personal lives and personal experiences, which enrich the sharing and enrich the Congress, the reason we are here, because we are here to join the souls in purgatory. And we are not talking about holy souls that are really very far away from us, somewhere in the shadows of Sheol, but we are here with them. And because the spiritual world is not in any space like we are. It is in the eternal presence of God, and there is no time and space in the spiritual world. So when we join the souls in purgatory, they are with us. And you can be sure about that. They are with us. I'm going to share with you this short reading from Matthew 12:32, and it says, "He who speaks against the Son of Man will be forgiven, but he who speaks against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven, either in this age or in the age to come." I know that we have received great teachings during this Congress, scriptural teachings about purgatory, wonderful passages that are so important to know and to have present in our life in order to remember that this is a church teaching. It's nothing that we made up. And when we speak about Protestants not believing it, I only remember that at one time, long time ago, when I began my ministry 21 years ago, I was at adoration in the Blessed Sacrament, very concerned about Protestants because I didn't know how to handle it. And then I opened the scriptures and I was reading St. Paul. I'm not good at quoting a scripture, but I was reading a passage that I'm sure you all know, where St. Paul is talking about that at the very end, there will be a new gospel being preached. A new gospel will be preached. And then I understood about Protestants, and I knew that they were the first ones that brought in a new gospel, and that I should be aware of that. And I stopped worrying about, and that was the end of it. And since then, I pray. That's all I do, but I don't get involved in arguments with them or spend time worrying about it. But it's very important to know that we do have Catholic teachings that certify to us, and actually it's a dogma of our church, that purgatory does exist. And if we are Catholics and we profess our faith, dogma means we have to believe it. Otherwise, we are not Catholics. And so when you hear a priest, a Catholic priest or bishop or whoever they are, a layman, a religious, denying the existence of purgatory, you can be sure that those stop being Catholics. It's like denying hell, denying Satan. They are not Catholics any longer, regardless that they still wearing the garments. But you have to believe dogma in order to profess your faith, because then what are we made of? Say, who are we? And what is it that we are professing? We are professing only what is convenient to us, or the areas that we prefer to profess, and the rest we just leave aside and deny them. So it's very important to have that clear. That's why I really appreciate all the teachings that we received through the weekend from very structured priests and from Bishop John. It's a great gift, you know, because if we only keep the information we got this weekend about purgatory, we will be rich enough to understand the importance of being very close to the souls. And, you know, I always tell people when they ask me about a retreat, and you know, there are so many great retreats in our church, so many charismas, and we appreciate them all. But I tell people, you know, if you want to go to the best spiritual retreat you could ever dream to go to a funeral, and hopefully to the funeral of someone you knew and someone you love very much. That would be an amazing retreat. And so much so that I just finished writing a novel called The Art of Knowing How to Live. But I was thinking of beginning another book. And yesterday, while I was watching one of the talks of this conference, it came to me, to my heart, that the next book I'm going to write is a novel also about a funeral. And it's going to be all about holy souls, about a conversation with a soul that I meet at a funeral. And I continue on a journey with that soul. Some of you don't know me, and some of you do. I am not a theologian, and I never studied religious sciences. I'm not an apologetical, but I am sharing with you a mystical experience with God that leads me also to share with you my mystical experience with holy souls and purgatory. And that is what I humbly share with you, not being a structure, a speaker in this theme. Now, I can give you a little example of what I mean mystic or mystical. One time, a long time ago, I was driving away from this city where I am now, Bogota, Colombia. It's where we have our mother house for the mission. And we have been here for all this year because of the pandemic. Usually we travel all around the world all the time. So this has been great for us prayer-wise, and also recollecting ourselves to do a stop on the way and recollect. So I'm driving away from this town. It's a big city, 12 million people. I'm driving away to a mission about an hour away from here. I'm by myself. And as I am reaching the end of this city, there is a toll plaza there. And before I reach the toll, a woman was on the left side of me at the edge of the road and trying to cross, and that is a place where you don't cross. That's like a highway, you know, and I knew she was gonna do it. And I said, oh, and I there was nothing I could do. I couldn't stop because I had lots of cars behind me. So the next thing I know, that woman went and crossed the highway and went right in front of me and went right in front of my hood onto the other side. So I thought I hit her, but I didn't feel any noise, anything. I didn't feel I touched anybody. So I looked through my rear view mirror, thinking she's laying on the road, but no, she was floating up in the air. And she had a long dress, she had the saddest face ever, and looked at me so clearly I could see her face, because it was not a natural thing. Obviously, it was a soul. And I drove away, praying for that soul, made it to the retreat, spent a few days there, came back to town, and as I was driving by the same spot, I noticed on the right side of me, from where the woman came, a cemetery of evangelicals. And at that moment, I got this incredible information coming from the cemetery. And they were telling me nobody prays for them. And that woman that crossed the road was like a messenger from the cemetery. She was like an ambassador. They knew I was gonna be able to see her. They knew I was gonna be back and I was gonna be driving by them. And they knew I will be receptive to what they were gonna communicate to me. All of that they knew. And I could tell you a long story about what they told me, but this I don't have the time now in this short space, but they let me know that we need to pray for Protestants, you know, a lot. There are many, many, those that were saved, obviously, many, many in purgatory. Very, very few make it to heaven after dying. Most of them a great percentage of them have to go through purgatory, and they have to complete the school of Christ. They have to complete it. They have to, and I'm sure that the ones that were Catholics and for some reason they walked away from the church and joined a cult of Protestants, they have more troubles than the ones that were born Protestants. And so I had for a time, I don't know how long, probably lasted a year, I don't know, time and time again, I had experiences with them. They kept on coming in different ways because it would be impossible for me to explain to you how they manifest, because sometimes it's just through thoughts, feelings in my body, and I know someone is there in many different ways. So, but they kept on coming, and I knew it was for prayers, and I knew many of them progress through those prayers. So I recommend you to pray for them. You know that one of the reasons we are doing what we are doing during this weekend is because we want to pray for the souls. We just don't want to talk about it. We just want to also pray. And that is the main reason we are doing this, so that we can pray for them, so that we can remember them. And you know, the most incredible gift about purgatory is that when we pray for souls, we are actually praying for ourselves too, because not only they will intercede for us, but also if we end up in purgatory one day, we will have people that will pray for us, because we did pray for them while we were here. And this is like an economy that we can call the soul's economy. If you want to get deeper into this, go into my YouTube channel, which is this one you are viewing right now. Subscribe and then look for the economy of the soul, and you will learn more about what I'm talking about. It. So it's just extraordinary what the communion of saints is about. See, we are a body, and we are being taught that our church teaches us about that body, the mystical body of Jesus, whose head is Jesus. And we are members of that body, living stones of the temple of God. And obviously, we all grow into that realm, because we know we are walking into this mystery of our salvation, and we are discovering it as we walk the walk of the gospel. And it, when we are faithful, you know, you hear from the testimonies of so many people that were falling away Catholics, or that didn't know much about their faith, though they were baptized, and so many beautiful stories, moving stories, especially because you see how mysteriously God moves in every one of us. And you hear the testimonies of people beginning to understand the reality of the spirit, the reality of transcendence into the next life. And it's just a joy to hear those testimonies, because what you are actually hearing is not just a human story. You are hearing the Holy Spirit at work. And that's what really matters of everything we do. Everything we testify, all the reflections and teachings of the priest and Bishop John and everyone that shared this Congress this weekend were just samples of how is it that the Holy Spirit actually moves in each one of us. That's what should give us the most important joy. You see, to understand that each one, by speaking the way they spoke, they are just showing to us the Holy Spirit at work. That's what it is. Because only because of the Holy Spirit, we are able to share this mystery of purgatory. I was talking about the Mount of Zion, in the city of Jerusalem on top of that mountain. And I was saying, we cannot forget that climbing that mountain, there is a spot called purgatory. See, when we walk with Jesus during this life, and we are conscious about our faith, we are constantly growing spiritually, and growing means we are actually filling ourselves with light. Because you see, the kingdom of God is the light. The kingdom of darkness is Satan, right? So when we walk with Jesus from the darkness where we were born, this earthly life, we walk towards the light. So the more we walk with him, the more we get to know him, the more we get to obey him, the more we get to know, to just dive into his love, the more light we gain. So when we take off from this life, and I say take off because I'm talking about someone that is filled with light, you can fly towards the Lord. So you can fly that mountain into the city of light. You will see the mountain going up. You will see it. Some people fly a little bit. Some people fly a little more. Some get almost close to the city. Some go straight into the city. But the steps I described, they only happen through purgatory, right? Very few can fly straight from the grave into the city. See, that's why I was saying funerals are very important. I have had a few experiences in funerals with the souls. And one of them was very sad because it was a woman that called me, and I was in Bogota. I'm very seldom here, but she was a young woman I met in a prayer group as when I began giving my testimony like 21 years ago. And she was like a model or something. She was in the entertainment business. But I haven't heard from her for years. And the phone rang, and it was a Sunday. Nobody was here, just me. And I usually never answer the phone, but I picked it up, and it was her. And she was crying and told me her brother had died, and he was in mortal sin. He was living a terrible life, and I think he OD'd on drugs or something. And he was begging me to go to the funeral house and pray with her. So I went there to pray with her, and she wasn't there. She came late. But the people that were there, they were all chatting away, laughing. No one was praying. No one was caring about this soul. And it was so hard for me to be there and to see that casket there alone, abandoned, ignored. And all those people that were completely blind about the spirit, about life, about God. And all of a sudden, I could see the shade of the soul, you know, by the coffin. And I he was so sad and so shocked. And it was so difficult that without any effort that I made or any emotion that I recall, I had lots of tears coming down my cheeks. And I didn't know how to deal with that moment. And then the girl, the sister, appeared. And when she looked at me, she knew me, you know, she knew my mystical experience, and she had been to many of my talks. So she looked at me and she said, "Tell me what he told you," just like that. And I couldn't lie to her, you know, because usually I am not the person that goes around telling everybody what I see, what I feel, what I hear mystically. I keep that to myself and mostly write it in my books, or once in a while it flows in one of my talks. But I don't make a ministry out of my mystical experiences. But I couldn't lie to her. So I said, yes, I am in view of him, not fully, but I can see you know, something in front of me, and I know it's him, and he's just devastated, really sad, in shock. He's having the hardest time to wake up into the spirit. He's so attached to that body in the casket. He's not wanting to let it go. So if one thing is important right now, go on your knees and pray a rosary and or as many rosaries as you can by the casket and pray to God so that he can let go of that body. See, he came accidentally off his body because that wasn't his time to die. He killed himself with drugs. So he appeared in the spiritual world prematurely. And there couldn't be a most horrifying thing to do than to kill yourself or provoke a premature death. You enter the spiritual realm prematurely. Just think about it. It's like when a baby is born prematurely. They put them in an incubator, right? And for a while, and souls, when they make it, they stay in a very tough incubator called purgatory, and it's a very low level, and it's very painful, dark, and it's painful. That's the word, painful. And demons still hover around and bother the soul and things like that. It's very difficult. So she went right beside the casket and began praying. I prayed there where I was standing. And well, that was the experience that time. Many things happened that day with this person, but I'm just sharing with you my experience about purgatory and what it means to me and what I have seen. And basically, the reason I'm sharing this with you is because I want to make sure that I testify to you that purgatory is a reality. It's nothing that we heard from somebody or that just the church tells us that purgatory exists. Purgatory does exist. And it's very important for us to unite with the souls. You should always remember them in each one of your prayers, in each one of your sacrifices. You know how many times you are confronted with difficult things in your life. You know, pity stuff, like things that you do at home with your family that cost you because they enable you, you know. It's like little things that ask you for an effort to be patient, to be tolerant, to be compassionate, to shut up, to keep to yourself, to put a filter, you know, not to speak up. And so many things happen to us every day. And I tell you, every little sacrifice that we offer for them is very powerful, more than you can imagine. It not only helps you to sanctify yourself, because if you hold back on something that is going to hurt somebody or hurt you, and you offer it for the souls, and immediately you feel the relief. You don't feel anymore what you were feeling a second ago. You feel the relief. You gave it to them. The Lord took it. The Lord used it. And someone was enlightened. Someone was pushed forward. See, you know what, if you could only know what it means to be pushed forward in purgatory, you will be pushing all the time because souls are stuck. You know, they are stuck in a situation that they are purifying themselves, purgating. Let's say some of the stages of your life, your earthly life, happen in a place of much conflict, family, life with lots of conflicts, arguments and things. So there were many times where you were uncharitable, you were filled with hatred and revenge and things like that. And you probably didn't come to terms with that. Maybe you were a Catholic that used to go to confession, but maybe you didn't really work hard enough to perfectionate your contrition and the study of your sins, you didn't reflect good enough. And you have a lot of pending accounts. And so all of that is very difficult in purgatory because you are actually there in the action. You know, what we go through in this earthly life stays in the eternal presence of God. So if it is not resolved through the sacrament of confession, then it's pending. Or if we did a bad confession, if we didn't bring it to confession, it's pending, it's alive. So you die and it's there and you have to resolve it. And it's not easy to resolve it once you leave the material world, because you are in a spiritual realm where you have no power over matter and you cannot do nothing over matter. And so everything you did it in the material world. How are you going to change it? You cannot change it. You have to purify it. You have to purgate it. And that's why we have to try to understand what it means. What does it mean, purgating? What does it mean, being purified? Yes, we can see how St. Paul tells us about in 1 Corinthians 3:10, I think Father Francis mentioned it today, about the fire, right? And how we are tested through the fire. We know that fire is the love of God. See, in heaven, it sanctifies, in purgatory, purifies, and in hell, it calcinates. It burns you up completely. So that fire is a very, very, very powerful fire. And depending of the state that you are in, depending of what is it that you are purgating, that's the intensity of the fire. So it's good to view that. It's good to understand that, so that every action in your life has a conscience. See, you have to be conscious. And you know that. You see, if you are a Catholic and you are a prayerful person and you are a sacramental Catholic, that you exercise your sacraments, you go to confession, you go to communion, you follow the liturgy in the liturgical seasons, you are an obedient Catholic, but you haven't worked hard enough in your relationship with your spiritual life regarding your actions and the spirit. See, it's like a balance. You have to have a good accounting. And you will know when something you did, something you said, something you felt, something you want, was not right. You see, it was wrong. You will know. But if you don't keep watch of that, that accumulates. See, that stays there in your realm. And that's what you don't want. You don't want to accumulate things like that in the realm of your life. You need to constantly be cleaning up. That's why Catholics go into retreats. That's why Catholics go into adoration to the Blessed Sacrament, a moment of silence, a moment of intimacy with the Holy Spirit, so the Holy Spirit can show you the things that are in you that you need to be aware of and that you need to change. And this is something constant. We need to be doing this all the time. And so purgatory is made of all these instances, all these little times that we don't pay much attention to. And obviously, it's also made of big actions that were wrong and that were not perfect and that need to be solved. And it's endless, the reasons why a soul will be in purgatory, because we are all unique souls, and no one like me, no one like you, no one sins like me, no one sins like you. So therefore, we have to atone for those sins in a unique way. And that atonement obviously happens within the fire of the love of Jesus, who is the judge, who is the purifying fire, and at the same time, the merciful fire. Because, you know, and we've been talking about that throughout the weekend, that if we want to describe purgatory, spiritually speaking, we will say it's mercy, it's compassion, it's a gift of God, it's a merciful suffering path. And so everything amounts to God's forgiveness. Look at the passage I just read to you. Jesus is talking about a sin against the Holy Spirit, a sin that will not be forgiven in this life or in the next life, which shows you that even in the next life, meaning after you die from this life, the next life, even there, sins are forgiven to those that God gives them the opportunity to purify themselves, to purgate whatever is pending at the moment of dying. So, but that sin against the Holy Spirit is not forgivable. So now you can bring yourself into the reality of your life right now. See, and think if you're ready. I don't know if you were tuning in yesterday when Father Philip from Ireland shared something powerful about a moment he was not able to breathe, and he thought it was his last breath. He thought he was going to die, and he said, "I'm not ready." Obviously, he said that to the Lord, right? And so think about that. Think about it. If this is our life. Our life is hanging from a breath. If you don't breathe more, you're gone, right? So catch your breath. Make sure you catch your breath on time. So, and if you cannot, because God won't let you, then be ready. So how much do we really work for that? See, most people are thinking, oh, I think I'm going to confession next week or next month. And some people ask you, how often do you go to confession? I tell people I go to confession as often as I need to, because things can happen anytime, and I need to get back my friendship with God immediately. But some people have a different idea about confessing. And you wonder, what are they doing? See, what if you die today? What if you are gone? You know, what if you cannot catch the next breath, like it was happening to Father Philip? So we know that it is vital for us to be ready. Something I heard from Father Francis today that I really loved was about knock and about the 100 masses, and how wonderful that God gave him the blessing to celebrate 200 masses, if I understood right. I think it was two times that he celebrated 100 masses during his illness. And I said, what an amazing gift. Because one of the things that impacted me most from Ireland was knock, to the point I am writing a book very slowly for a few years. It's a mystical book about my experiences in knock that were very rich, and they are mystical. And just the fact that that place is about the souls in purgatory, it brings you to a special, very special realm. I recommend everybody that is tuned in to check on knock and find out about what knock is about. It's just an incredible apparition. And so you see, I received the gift in knock, very important to me. Every time I went there, the first time I went to mission in Ireland, in the Republic of Ireland, was in 2003. And I went to the basilica there, and they told me all about the story with the souls. So I had some masses said for the souls of my family. And among them, there was a brother of mine that was very concerned. He died in the sea, and his body was never recovered. So I prayed for him, have some masses said, and left to Portugal. And while I was in Portugal, in the island of Madeira, I had, before I woke up, this vision of my brother. And he was coming down a hill, and I was behind him, and he was going down very fast. I was trying to catch up. And then as he turned around a mountain and disappeared, I turned around too and found him sitting on a rock, and he was filled with light and smiling. But during the time he was going down the hill, he was relating to me the same mystical experience I had, as if he had it too. And it was exactly like mine. And I was thinking while he was talking, well, that's what happened to me too, exactly that. So I was kind of curious why he related my mystical experience as if it was his. But then the message God gave me is that my brother was saved. And that was a great gift that I got from Nock. And I'm forever thankful. And Nock has been an amazing, powerful experience for my mission and for my experience with Our Lady, the experience of purgatory. And that priest that celebrated the masses, I'm sure is a very holy priest. And I don't know what they're doing about his life, but it's worth it. I hope they look into it if they are not yet. So I pray to God for all of you, and especially pray for all the departed of your families, and pray so that each one of us become very aware about the need to pray for the souls. We need to be this communion of saints that the church asks us to be. We need to acknowledge the need to transcend the awareness that we are next. You and me are next. We are parting. We are leaving this world very soon. I don't know how long it's going to take for you or for me. Whatever time you think you're going to be still here, still is very short, because we are walking, we will be walking into eternity. So we have to keep that in mind. It's very important for us to be aware that life doesn't end at the tomb. It goes on. And I have seen it with my own eyes. Life goes on. This is serious. We need to be prepared. We need to be as holy as you possibly can. And it's not a joke. We live in a material world that tells us the opposite. Don't let yourself be enchanted by the singing of the sirens. Just go for the singing of the angels of God and prepare yourself. That way you can fly up to the city of Jerusalem and you will escape purgatory. And that's what God wants us to do, to go straight to heaven. But for that, we need to sanctify ourselves. Only saints enter heaven. So make sure you become one while you are here. How long do you have? You don't know. How long does it take to become a saint? Just ask the Lord to give you the grace, because if you take a true decision about it now, God knows that you mean it, and that sanctifies your life. You have to be serious about it. Take that decision. It's the most important decision of your life. God bless.
Se tu vai in cielo,
se tu vai in cielo,
prima di me,
prima di me,
apri un
buchino,
e tira su anche me,
e tira su anche me.
Se tu vai in cielo prima di me, apri un buchino e tira su anche me. Ai, ai, ai.